Hello, my name is Peter van Bergijk. I have worked on deglobalization since I became professor at Erasmus University in 2009. 10 years of research have led to many publications, and today I want to share what I've learned and to introduce my latest book, Deglobalization 2.0. We know globalization from our own experience very well. This graph shows how the share of international trade in world production has increased since 1880. Increasing trade, foreign investment, travel and international cooperation, that is the tune of our life. But that picture has spun recently as we have entered a period of deglobalization in which openness of the world economy is actually decreasing. And according to recent forecast, deglobalization is here to stay and may even deepen. So don't you think that we live in strange and unusual times? We seem to live in the times of Trumpism, Brexitism, and deglobalization. Our epoch definitely feels like something unique, but it is not. Indeed, our grandparents have been here before. Of course, the voices and the characters on the world stage are different. But the stories of the Great Depression of the 1930s and the Great Recession that we are still living today are to a large extent similar. My book, Deglobalization 2.0, argues that we need to study both periods together in order to understand where we are and where we are going. The start of the storyline is a financial crisis that reduces demand and destroys confidence. Next follows a collapse of world trade and investment that marks the end of decades of intensifying globalization. This world trade and investment collapse starts a period of deglobalization that at first remains hidden under the veil of initial recovery, but later becomes clear and measurable. This is what happened in the 1930s, and it is happening today. The most powerful man of the world is perceived by many as an irresponsible, if not irrational, president that spoils the international order that sensible men and women have been constructing since the Second World War. A world order in which trade, democracy, and peace reinforced one another and have brought tremendous gains in knowledge and material welfare. This is a serious game that is now being spoiled in a reality show that has driven many of my friends and colleagues to stop watching the 8 o'clock news. I do not disagree with the assessments that the world order is under threat of recent US activities. But I disagree if one argues that the policy is irrational. It is dangerous, yes, but we can understand why it is happening. To some, it is especially worrying that the retreat from globalization appeared to start in democracies, because the Bretton Woods institution, and likewise the European Union, have been built by democracies. Indeed, my analysis shows that there is a significant difference with the 1930s, when in contrast, deglobalization did not move as fast in democracies as it did in autocracies. So popular anti-globalist movements currently seem to hit the system at the heart. While I don't want to downplay the issue of populism, it is, however, important to recognize that the turning point of globalization in major economies appears to have occurred around the start of the Great Recession, well before Brexit and the election of President Trump. Many observers make the error of blaming Mr. Trump and Brexit for deglobalization. They are wrong and confuse the symptoms and the causes of the disease. Why are Mr. Trump and Brexit only symptoms? Because the virus of deglobalization is widespread. It occurs everywhere. It is equally important to see that the phenomenon of deglobalization requires a much broader conceptualization than the backlash from globalization or the retreat from globalization that are already being recognized by many authors. Because deglobalization also occurs in countries where support for globalization is still strong. And that is a puzzle that has not yet been addressed. Moreover, the idea that we have entered a phase of deglobalization is contested by many observers. They argue that what we see is the consequence of new technologies that reduce material flows, new modes of finance, new strategies, and insourcing of international value chains. Other observers argue that we have a pause in globalization. This disbelief in what the data tell us is matched by the many authors that have predicted that the rhetoric of make America great again would remain words only, and that Brexit would be a ripple rather than the tsunami that its exit from the European Union is creating. That may of course be right, and it may be too early to tell. But my point is that globalization and deglobalization are recurring phases of our economic system. Because of this recurrence, it is important not only to study the current situation, but also to look at its major predecessor, to find communalities and differences. This is why we need to study both the 1930s, that is deglobalization 1.0, and the 2000s, that is deglobalization 2.0. This is why you should read my book.